Joshua Benjamin Peace Day, so you can be recognized.
Amen.
Thank you.
Well,
in case you were wondering why I've been introducing Joshua to one of his sisters, well, we go way back. As a matter of fact, I am his first and very best friend. We are more like brothers. So let me tell you a little about my friend Joshua. Joshua Benjamin is 8 years old and was born on November 15, 2010 at the North Central Hospital in the Bronx, NY, to Cheryl Williams and Tubbo Benjamin. He attends the Highview Elementary School and is currently in the third grade. Like most boys, Joshua loves sports, and his favorite sports include basketball, soccer, and track and field. Joshua enjoys reading and dancing with his sisters, and we both love to have sleepovers at each other's house. Joshua plays the violin at his school band and is very interested in drums. Joshua says that when he grows up, he would like to be a firefighter and a basketball player. His favorite Bible character is Daniel. His favorite Bible verse is Luke chapter 6, verse 31. Do to others as you would have them do to you. And his favorite song is Lift Your Voice and Sing. Brothers and sisters, boys and girls, the next voice you'll hear after the song of meditation by the children's choir will be that of my longtime playmate and best friend, Joshua Benjamin.
Thank you.
Thank you, Josiah, for that lovely introduction. This is the day that the Lord has made. Finish it with me. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Happy Sabbath, church. What a blessing it is for me, Joshua Benjamin, to be standing here before you today as God's messenger. Before moving forward, I first would like to thank Pastor Downing for allowing me to represent and minister an FWP here at church and on the World Wide Web. Thank you, Pastor Downing. Thanks to my dear mom and sisters and church family for training me up in the way that I shall go. And by God's grace, I will not depart from you. Finally, to our Heavenly Father for loving me and dying for me and for being a part of my life. And for that I say, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for everything. Please stay with me as I share with your people today. Amen.
Amen.
God gives us the power to obey. Power is a good thing when used wisely. Would you agree with me?
Yes.
A power from God. Well, that's big, that's awesome, and that's a blessing.
Amen.
Psalm 51 verse 5 says that we were shaped in iniquity and born in sin. So brothers and sisters, is that the reason why rejecting the power to obey God overpowers us, even though we try so hard to obey? God created us out of love. God had great plans for us. But because of disobedience, we still need the blueprint in order to survive in the beautiful world that He had made for us. And that blueprint is the Bible, which includes the Ten Commandments. God gave us the power to obey Him, only because He loves us so very much and wanted us to have life with meaning. Exercising the power to obey comes only from having an honest, loving relationship with the Master and Creator.
Amen. True.
Power to obey produces success and success victory.
Yes.
All benefits that comes only with the help of the Holy Spirit and not from our works. So please let us not boast. When God's children chose obedience, we will always walk out of the fiery furnace like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We will be royals like Joseph and leaders like Esther. Applying the power to obey brings joy, rewards, and blessings. For example, a father won a toy gift at the office. He called his three young children to ask which one should have the present. Who is the most obedient? He asked. The children all looked at him in silence. He asked, who never talks back to mother? Again, the kids seemed to be puzzled by the question. Then the father asked, who does everything that mother says? Well, with that question, the kids were finally able to answer. Together, three small sad voices shouted, okay, Dad, you get the toy. This story, brothers and sisters, reminds us that the rewards will always be great when we embrace the power to obey.
Amen.
Even our parents are clever enough to know who they must obey.
Jesus.
Bible says to obey is better than
sacrifice.
But sacrifice what? Mm. Well, we can sacrifice our health, our happiness, and eventually our salvation. We are kept by the power of God. This is why we can be in the world but not out of the world.
Amen.
We can only obey when we accept the God-given power to obey. But sometimes we sadly reject that power with disobedience.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, boys and girls, today I have had the fundamental beliefs that is shared by members of our faith. As we continue to study God's word, we should see and agree that we do possess
the power to obey. Now what we do with that power is totally up to you and totally up to me. We accept and receive the power to obey, but we believe and receive Jesus Christ by faith through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. So as we go along serving God, let us be mindful of the great song that says, trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy in Jesus. But trust and obey. Thank you.
Amen.
Will Jaden Thomas family please stand so that you can be recognized?
Amen.
Thank you. Jaden Thomas is 10 years old and was born on October 16, 2008 at New York University Hospital in Manhattan, New York to Monique Daniels and James Thomas. He is the younger of two siblings. Jaden attends the Albert J. Oliver School in the Bronx, New York, and is currently in the fifth grade. Jaden enjoys drawing characters and fruits, reading books, playing adventure games, and riding the scooter. Jaden is a very caring person and is usually sharing what he has with others. When Jaden grows up, he wants to be in law enforcement or a software designer. Jaden's favorite Bible character is David, and his favorite Bible passage is Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27. God created man in his own image. And his favorite song is Our God is Great. Brothers and sisters, boys and girls, the next voice you will hear after the special music selection by the children's band will be that of my little brother, Jaden Thomas.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, First Flight Players. I am grateful to be chosen to be one of the speakers to deliver God's word to you today. But before I begin, I would like to thank Pastor Dowden for letting me... I would also like to thank Pastor Dowden for allowing me to stand in this pulpit. It is indeed an honor. Thank you, Pastor. I would also like to thank my parents and the Children's Ministry Department for helping me prepare for this presentation. The goal is more important than the role. A thought-provoking topic, isn't it? As I unpack this topic, I will focus on the following three key points. One, every part of the body of Christ is important. Two, lack of support and encouragement can stunt growth and development of talent. And three, being the best at what we are, however small our role, is God's ideal goal for us. Let's pray. Dear God, you have my lips, my eyes, my ears, and hands, and every part of my being that will be engaged in the delivery of your message to your people today. And prepare the hearts to receive your words. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So let's turn to the first key point. Every part of the body of Christ is important. Recently, I was given a part in my school play, The Little Mermaid. My character was Cecil the Snake. While Cecil was one of many characters in the play, he was not the main character. The main character was Annabelle, who had most of the lines in the play. In the entire play, Cecil only had 8 lines. There was also another character in the play, Prince, who had several lines to recite. I really loved the Prince character, but I realized that part was not given to me. It was just not my part. Instead of playing roles that were not mine, I buckled down and focused on my small part. Based on the applause we received at the end of performance, I could tell that I really nailed my part. The best part, however, is that all the cast did an amazing job. The entire performance was a success. Could you imagine if I had decided to, on the day of the performance, that I was going to play Prince? That would have been such a disaster. Teamwork really makes the dream work. I like to think of our gifts or talents as superpowers. For some of us younger ones, this might be a way for us to embrace our gifts. So keeping with this imagery, do you know that everyone of us has at least one superpower? Amen. Yes, we do. However, we sometimes forget to use the one that we are given. These superpowers that God has given us can simply be whatever it is we're good at. As a young person, it's not always easy to figure out our special gifts, but we can pray and ask God to reveal our gifts to us. There are also surveys we can do to determine what our gifts are. Every role is important and contributes to the mission and programs of the church. We all have a part to play in ministering to others and leading them to Christ or strengthening their relationship with God. We sometimes see the pastor's role as the most important, failing to realize without the choirs, praise teams, musicians, Sabbath school teachers, ushers, and the hospitality team, as well as the general membership who invite friends, classmates, co-workers, and family members, are all roles that contribute to the worship and fellowship experience and to the body of Christ as a whole. Every role is indeed important, and they all work together for the cause of Christ and the common good. Now turn to the person on your left and say, you're unique and there is a role for you in the body of Christ. Spiritual gifts are special talents or abilities the Holy Spirit gives us to strengthen one another and help one another and build one another up and ultimately bring glory and honor to God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the apostle Paul spends quite some time talking to the brethren in Corinth about spiritual gifts. He said in verses 4 through 7 that it's the same God who gives us our individual gifts, and that our gifts must be used for the common good or the benefit of all, that is, the body of Christ. Further down in chapter 12, Paul tells a very important fact. that the Holy Spirit contributes to each of us just as he deserves.
Amen.
Boys and girls, brothers and sisters, it is the Holy Spirit who decides or determines who gets what gift. Isn't that amazing? Because
Amen.
God is the giver of every good and every perfect gift. He knows what's best for us.
Yes.
And so we should nurture and grow our God-given talents and not waste them. Now let's turn to our second key point. Lack of support and encouragement can stunt growth and development of talent. What I'm about to say here is very important for all of us. So can you please indulge me with your full attention? Okay, here goes. When the youth serve in any capacity, big or small, let us encourage them all equally with our rousing amens.
Amen.
So keep up the good work and nice job comments afterwards.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Yes.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Did you know that our support and encouragement can help to boost our confidence?
Yes,
yes, we do care.
Yes.
And it helps to know when you want the best in us.
Yeah.
It's your expectations of us and your support and encouragement that helps us working at improving our skills.
Right.
And if we don't support and encourage each other as a body, our young people will be less engaged, and as we see sometimes, they will be unwilling to serve when asked. In other words, let none of us be responsible for stunting the future growth and development of the talent of our young people, as they all are important to the proper functioning of the body of Christ.
Amen.
Now for our final key point, being the best at what we are, however small our role, is God's ideal role for us. Proper use of our gifts and pursuit of excellence in the things we're good at benefits the body of Christ and advances his cause.
That's right.
Just like a great defense contributes to significantly winning a basketball game.
Yeah.
Let's be motivated to being our best selves and contributing to all of our cause of Christ,
right,
knowing that our effort will be recognized and rewarded in the blessings of both.
Amen.
Also, let's remember that higher than the highest human thoughts can reach is God's ideal goal for us, his children. Like the 10 servants of the nobleman in Luke 19, verse 12-27. We will have to give an account of our individual talents. It is on us to nurture and grow our God-given talents and not waste them. Through the scripture, we all know that God values our body. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19 and 20, tells us that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who's in us. We are called to take care of and honor God with our bodies. God's words guide us to use our bodies and the gifts that he has given us to achieve the will of God. And in Romans 12, verse 1, we are beseeched to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God, because this is our true and proper worship. So if our bodies belong to God, everything that we do with it should be about glorifying and honoring God. This means that we should do our best in everything that we can do. So boys and girls, brothers and sisters, the question each of us must ask ourselves is, have I faithfully used the gift or superpower God has given me to serve and bless others? Have I used my gift to contribute to the body of Christ? And have I shared my gifts with others to multiply God's kingdom? As I wrap up, I'd like to share with you a great story that I heard that really captured the gist of my topic. The story was told by a woman whose husband was a professional basketball player. It was his job to be all about the defense. His role was to make sure that the other team did not get shots. Now that meant he didn't get any shots on the scoreboard. So when everyone else was bragging about the points they made, he could not join in. As a matter of fact, the games where he did make a lot of points, the team usually lost. But the games where he did not get a lot of points, those were the games the team won. Because he was spending his time doing exactly what he was supposed to be doing. Not shooting, but being all about the defense, as that was his role. He might not have gotten the award for scoring the most points in the game, but no one would get by him because his defense was tight. Now the best part of all this is that his coach knew his value and so did his teammates. Right. And he was always recognized for the contribution for the team.
That's right. Amen.
As a matter of fact, we could all learn a great lesson from the story the woman told during her story. God has blessed every believer with spiritual gifts. And the Bible says that God has put all the gifts in his body the way he sees fit.
That's right.
We should not get caught up with the gifts we have and the gifts someone else has.
Amen.
And God, his wisdom, has blessed us with our own given talents. And that thought alone should excite us. We should get to be co-laborers with Christ to build up the kingdom of God. And that goal is more important than all of these roles.
Amen.
Thank you, and have a good rest of Children's Day.
Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy Sabbath.
Will Marcelo Thomas's family please stand so that you can be recognized?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Marcelo Thomas is 13 years old and was born on August 2nd, 2005 at Nyack Hospital in Nyack, New York, to Jessica and Mark Thomas Sr., and is the younger of two children. Marcelo attends the Missing Valley Middle School in Slate Hill, New York, where she is in the 8th grade. She's an honor roll student and a 3-time MVP award recipient for academics and discipline.
Amen.
Kayla's interests include reading, writing, and making scientific experiments. She also enjoys drawing, painting, and photography, and is proficient at the piano. And like most teenagers, she enjoys watching YouTube videos. Marquela is actively involved in sports. She plays basketball, volleyball, and runs track and field. And in 2017, she received the National Fitness Award signed by our former President Barack Obama.
Amen.
Marquela hopes to pursue a career in either the field of law or education. Marquela's favorite Bible character is Samson, and her favorite song is Intentional by Travis Greene.
Yes.
Marquela's favorite Bible reading is the one where Solomon executed his God-given gift of wisdom to resolve a quarrel between two women who both had babies. Mm. But the other mother, whose baby had died in the night, switched her dead baby with the other woman's baby, then argued that the live baby was her. You can read the full story in 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 16 to 28. Brothers and sisters, boys and girls, the next voice you will hear after the special music will be that of my little sister, Marquela.
Amen.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, First White Plains. It is indeed a privilege and honor to stand before you today to deliver God's word. Thank you, Mark, for that lovely introduction, and Demetrius, Maya, and Mala for that beautiful rendition. I would like to thank Sister Debbie Ann and the Children's Ministry Department for selecting me today to deliver God's word. And a special thank you to Pastor Dowding for allowing me to use your pulpit today. Earlier in the year, when I was asked to be one of the Children's Day speakers, I must confess that excitement was not the feeling I had. In fact, I was very nervous and hoped that they would forget that they asked me to speak. And to my horror, not only was I asked to present the word, but I was also asked to play a piano piece for AY. Right. Two things I've never done at FWP. I learned very quickly, however, that I was not going to get out of this because Sister Debbie had convinced both my parents and got the support before approaching me. Once I realized that this was going to happen, I began preparing myself mentally to stand before you today.
Amen.
A big thank you to my parents for helping me prepare for today. Please pray that God will use me as an instrument in his work.
Amen.
The title of our message today is Our God is a God of Second Chances.
Amen.
A do-over. That is what I think of when I hear the word second chance. A do-over is defined as a chance of doing something for a second or additional time after an unsuccessful first attempt. Note, however, that my topic today is not about the singular second chance. Instead, it's all about the plural, second chances.
My Lord.
In these two words, we see mercy, forgiveness, patience, love, long-suffering, and hope, all characteristics of our wonderfully Heavenly Father.
Yes.
So being the last speaker, I have a big favor to ask to get you all energized. Say to your neighbor, multiple chances. Now say to your neighbor, do over without penalty.
Do over without penalty.
And lastly, say to your neighbor, God sets us up for success in our do-overs.
God sets us up for success in our do-overs.
Yes, indeed he does. These are three assurances provided in God's word and that we will explore in the next few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Let us pray. Dear Father, we are thankful that even though we don't always obey your word, you give us second chances to get it right with you. Please help us to follow your word and be a beacon of light in our work, school, and community. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In sports, a sudden death run is a form of competition where a play ends as soon as one competitor gets ahead of the other. Sudden death is often used as a tiebreaker when a game is tied at the end of our normal playing time. Our normal playing time ended when man first sinned in Eden. Mm-hmm. Since then, mankind has been playing a sudden death run. As soon as we sin, we should technically die. But through God's grace and mercy, through his bloodshed on the cross for our sins and his forgiveness, we have a chance to stay in the game for a little longer. When we call upon God's name, we no longer face a sudden death, but instead we get access to a sudden victory. Say amen, church.
Amen.
What a mighty God we serve.
Amen.
Only a loving God like ours can turn sudden death into sudden victory and life everlasting.
Amen.
This is possible because of our all-knowing, all-seeing God made provision to give us mankind, to give mankind a second chance and redeem us from the foundation of the world. John 3:16 tells us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. So, let's come back to the do-over concept. If you play sports or a musical instrument or participate in the visual or performing arts, you must be familiar with the concept of a do-over. Yes?
Yes.
A do-over is a chance of performing without mistakes after a failed attempt. Second chances are critical when striving for excellence in this life.
True.
Likewise, second chances are necessary for sinful man to gain victory over sin. The story is told that when Thomas Edison was struggling to perfect the light bulb, it took his team of workers 24 hours to put together just one light bulb.
Amen.
When the team was finished with the one light bulb, Edison gave it to a young boy to carry upstairs. Step by step, the boy carefully climbed the stairs, afraid he might drop this priceless piece of work. You could probably guess what happened.
Mm-mm.
The poor boy dropped the bulb at the top of the stairs. It took the team of workers another 24 hours to produce another light bulb. Once again, Edison gave it to the same young boy who had dropped the first one. This time, he gave the boy the bulb in a box lined with soft felt. Mr. Edison gave the boy a second chance. Did you get the feeling that if the boy managed to drop the bulb again, Edison might have given him another chance? We will never know. But one thing we know for sure, our God has and continues to give us more than a second chance to get things right. As a matter of fact, he gives us multiple chances. Our God is so awesome, he gives us countless do-overs. There are many examples in the Bible of when God has given his people multiple chances. There's Noah, Moses, David, Jonah, Peter, and countless others. We're all trophies of God's grace and forgiveness. Let's take a look at more of a couple of the noteworthy ones. Moses, the leader of God's people in Exodus from Egypt to Canaan, earlier in his life murdered an Egyptian. David, the great king of Israel, coveted another man's wife and had the man murdered. And lastly, Peter, a great preacher before Pentecost, spent all of his time following Jesus around, but was not converted. Are we like Peter? Do we come to church week after week but are not really converted? I'm here to tell you that there is yet hope for us. We have a forgiving and long-suffering Lord and Savior who gives us second chances if we believe and confess our sins. Noah, Moses, David, Jonah, and Peter are proof of this fact. They are all examples of men who, after repeated offenses, repented and went on to be witnesses and faithful servants of God. Our God is not only a God of second chance, but he is a God of multiple chances. And you know what? This is really good news for us, because most of us mess up our second chance fairly quickly. One of the amazing truths of God is that he is incredibly patient and long-suffering. Psalm 86:15 says it well. But you, O Lord, are a God of merciful and graciousness, slow to anger and abundant in steadfast love. Now, let's talk about how God gives us second chances, or do-overs, without penalty. Baptism is a perfect representation of God's forgiveness and generosity. Images of our sin being buried in a watery grave of baptism, a new life, rebirth through Christ, and being washed of our filthy sins so we are whiter than straw, illustrate the thoroughness of God's forgiveness and significance of our second chances we have. With God, our second chances are not marred by our past behavior. Micah 7:19 tells us that God will tread our sins underfoot and cast them away into the depths of the sea. In other words, our past sins are not held against us. God's forgiveness wipes our slate completely clean of all the bad things we have done in the past. Do you know anyone who would love to dig up your past at every opportunity you get? Yes. Especially when you're trying to stay on the straight and narrow? We don't appreciate that kind of behavior. Do we? Nope. We want to tell them, all right, but that's in the past and I'm different now. But that's the way the devil works. He wants us to dwell on our past and not look to Jesus for renewal. He wants us to believe that we are too bad and not worth God's renewing power. But I'm here to tell you that the devil is a liar. God gives us multiple chances, and he does not hold our failures or wrongdoings against us when he wipes our slate clean. 1 John 1:9 tells us that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God's gift and forgiveness comes with no penalty when we are forgiven. We stand before God as if we have never sinned, robed in the perfect life of his Son, Jesus. He does not remember the failed first chances we get, and we are given a fresh start. So, after we've made multiple mistakes, confessed and asked for forgiveness, how can we move forward? Can we straighten up and fly right in our own strength? We are told to get serious and start behaving properly, do better, and try harder. But one thing we know for certain, we cannot conquer sin without God's help. You see, these multiple chances we get, they are not for us to do better and perfect our behavior in our own strength. 2 Corinthians 12:9 tells us that his strength is made perfect in our weaknesses, and I thank God for that. I love that God does not just forgive us and leave it totally up to us to get it right the second time. He gives us the resources we need to stay on the right path. In other words, God sets us up for success in our do-overs. In the parable of the fig tree in Luke 13, we see a great example of a second chance and a setup for success in action. The vineyard owner went to his vineyard 3 years in a row expecting to find figs on his tree, but there were none, not a single one. So he instructed the keeper of the vineyard to cut it down because it was just taking up space and using up the soil. The parable went on to say that the keeper of the vineyard begged the owner to allow him to leave the tree for one more year so he can dig around it and put fertilizer on it and give it another chance to bear fruit. He told the owner that if the tree had fruit the next year, they would leave it. But if not, they will cut it down as the owner had requested. Mm. In the story, the owner of the vineyard is God.
Yes.
The keeper of the vineyard is Jesus, and the tree represents us,
Amen.
God's children.
Jesus.
The fertilizer and the working of the soil represents God's word and God's Holy Spirit
Hallelujah.
Working in our hearts.
Amen.
Sometimes we don't always produce the kind of fruit God expects of us. We have a loving and forgiving God.
Jesus.
And just as the owner of the vineyard gave the fig tree a second chance, God gives us a second chance too. But more importantly, we aren't left to get it right by ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Like the keeper of the vineyard helped the tree improve its odds of bearing figs by adding fertilizer and working soil, we have instructions in God's holy word,
Hallelujah.
Assistance from the Holy Spirit, and the gift of prayer to help overcome and produce good fruits.
Thank you, Jesus.
Aren't you happy that we have a loving and forgiving God
who
not only gives
Amen.
Us multiple chances,
right.
but also gives us His word, the
Amen.
Holy Spirit, and access to Him through prayer
Amen.
To help us obey His word and gain victory? Over sin, what a gracious, forgiving
Amen.
God. Now, what will you do with your second chance?
Mm-hmm.
Our earthly parents love us so much that they will do anything to ensure our happiness and safety. Like God, they will also forgive us for some of the bad behavior that we do many times.
Mm-hmm.
They tell us countless times to tidy up our rooms and put away the toys. Stop playing games on the phone in church and get off social media and YouTube during homework time. But there comes a time when they have repeated the same admonition without the desired effect. They have to take action. For many of you, the worst might be losing your treasure device, while others might not be able to do that fun activity. While God's mercies are new every morning and His long-suffering is like no other, we will not have unlimited chances of forgiveness forever. Sin will ultimately be destroyed.
Amen.
There will come a time when the door of forgiveness will be closed.
Mm-hmm.
1 Thessalonians 5:19 and Ephesians 4:30 warn us not to quench the greed of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yes, even Christ has a limit on forgiveness. When we consistently choose to disobey God's commandments and run our lives the way we want to rather than the way God wants to, we risk quenching and grieving the Holy Spirit. When we repeatedly say mean things about our classmates or friends in church, or when we covet others for what they have,
Amen.
When we repeatedly disrespect our parents and adults in our lives, when we repeatedly stab a brother or sister in the back,
yes.
when we repeatedly tell a little white lie again and again, we risk grieving the Holy Spirit and getting to the point where wrong seems like right to us and we can no longer seek God. Brothers and sisters, boys and girls, let's remember that we have a loving and forgiving God who, one, gives us multiple chances to get right, two, that He gives us second chances without penalty, and lastly, another reason why God is so amazing is three, He sets us up for
Amen.
Success.
Amen.
Amen.
Knowing that our chances of forgiveness will not be forever unlimited, but will run out at some point, let's ask ourselves, what if today is my last chance? What if I had one more chance today? Who wants to commit today to use a second chance wisely and use the resources God has provided for him in our word, the Holy Spirit, and prayer to stay connected with him? If you do, will you please stand to your feet as a demonstration of your commitment?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank
you.
Amen.
Dear God, we want to thank you for being a loving and gracious God and giving us second chances to get things right with you and giving us access to your holy word. Please help us to obey and stay connected with you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.